Philippines' richest man, Manny Villar, is joining the REIT bandwagon. His real estate business, Vistaland, has just filed for a 9 billion peso or a $176 million IPO for Vista REIT. Joining us this morning for more on this, Vistaland CFO Brian Edang. Hi, Brian. Good morning. Thank you for taking our call.
Good morning. No, always welcome.
All right. So why now and why Vista REIT? I mean, you've got six other REITs competing for attention. Why Vista REIT?
Well, first of all, I'll answer why now. I think it's the right time, considering that the economic and the retail recovery of the Philippines is seen. Plus, the properties that we have put in our flagship REIT company is already 97% occupancy level. Mm-hmm. And actually, these properties perform well amidst the pandemic and the lockdown. Mm-hmm. Our initial portfolio are composed of 10 community malls. Mm-hmm. And two office buildings. I mean, just to note, Vistaland has about over 100 commercial developments across the country, which is about 1.6 million square meters of gross floor area. And V-REIT actually just accounts for about 22%. Mm-hmm. On your next question, what's the differentiation of our Vista REIT to the rest? Well, the composition of the assets of our REITs actually is the difference from the other REIT. This is the first REIT company that is offering majority community malls in its portfolio. Mm-hmm. Our community malls are strategically located within or near Vistaland developments. I mean, this became relevant, especially during the pandemic, because of the lockdowns were implemented. Mm-hmm. Even before the pandemic, having a commercial establishment near Vistaland developments are actually a necessity, considering the traffic, plus now the cost of gasoline. People are opting to shop and have their needed services within the nearby commercial mm-hmm. development. Mm-hmm. Another factor for the resiliency of our malls are actually the tenant mix, which are majority essential. We have a synergy with the Villar Group's retail ecosystem of world-class retail formats, publicly listed all home and all day supermarket, mm-hmm. and private concepts such as Coffee Project, Old Toys, Vista Cinemas, Kinder Cities, to name a few. Mm-hmm. We are offering an elevated mall experience coming from our high quality and world-class anchor tenants.
Brian, for those who are watching who are not too familiar with the terms and definitions, how would you define a community mall and how is it different from the other malls, from the traditional ones that we often talk about?
Yeah, a community mall is, just like most of our malls are actually situated within or near the Vista development, so it's actually walking distance to our existing project.
Is it necessarily smaller than the traditional mall?
Because we started with our malls with really not so big. I mean, because we own the land within the nearby areas anyway, mm-hmm. we start with probably a 20,000 to 30,000 gross floor area in square meters. Mm,
20,000 to 30,000 square meters. Gross floor area. Okay. Brian, we're seeing a lot of inflows into REITs lately. Why do you think REITs are a good investment vehicles in an environment of, extreme volatility? You've got geopolitical tensions, the economies are reopening, and interest rates are about to go up. Why are REITs attractive, you think?
Well, I think because of, you have the best of both worlds, as you mentioned a while ago. I mean, you get the recurring income from the dividends that it provides, plus the capital appreciation because it's a listed company. It's a listed stock.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So far, we've got office space REITs from the others that have come before, RE REIT plus industrial warehousing REIT coming up from the Injap Tan Kak Yong Group. And you are doing community malls plus office spaces. What about the other formats? Are you looking to venture into other formats like residential REITs, for example, or hotel and resorts, data center REITs? Are you looking at the possibility of venturing into those?
I mean, we're always open, mm-hmm. but I think right now, because what we have in our existing portfolio, Vistaland, we have most of it are actually commercial developments of malls, mm-hmm. combination of malls and a majority malls and office space. So I think that's where we are. I mean, we're going to infuse more of these assets in our flagship REIT. Mm-hmm. And eventually, if we have those projects that you mentioned, data centers and stuff, I mean, eventually we may be able to put in them.
All right. You are planning to offer 3.67 billion shares of V-REIT, a maximum of 2.5 per share. What sort of dividend yield are we looking at?
for 2022, the 8 months remaining months for this projected is about 5.6% yield. Looking at 2023 full year, that's about 6.4 at offer price.
Okay, that's a pretty in line with most other REITs. Now, outside of REITs, though, Brian, what parts of the real estate industry do you think will deliver the best results this year? I mean, a lot of the real estate movement lately has been, you know, in data centers, cell towers.
Yeah, well, for our case, I mean, we still stick to the, you know, our core business, which is residential.
Residential.
You know, we're optimistic with the property outlook for this year. I mean, due to a lot of factors. One, overseas Filipino remittances is projected to grow again. 60% of our sales are actually from overseas Filipino. Huh. And then we have seen confidence in overseas Filipinos because, you know, confidence in buying big ticket items such as property purchases. You know, we have seen... We have also seen an uptick in demand for upmarket products like our Crown Asia, Brittany, and residences. For our commercial properties, actually, we have seen marked improvement in footfalls. We even see foot traffic exceeding pre-pandemic levels. So having that, you know, we actually announced 31 Vista Estates across. Vista Estates are version of integrated master plan communities geared towards commercial and vertical development. So. Watch out for our announcement of those Vista Estates in the coming weeks.
Yeah, exciting times ahead, Brian. Before we let you go, let's talk about price pressures. I mean, you did say that you cater to OFWs. To what extent are you able to pass on, you know, or to raise rents, for example, in your commercial spaces, or pass on some of the inflationary pressure to buyers of your properties? And let's not forget, interest rates are going up, so cheap money is not going to be as cheap as they are today, tomorrow.
Well, we can pass on, you know, the inflationary increases. But the good thing about our products is, for example, in housing, I mean, the commodity prices of cement is not that much, which is the majority of houses. But the good thing, I think, is we're selling value. So, I mean, at the end of the day, I mean, you don't put price on the value of the property. I mean, it's a primary need for the household. So having your own house is different. And I think, yeah, but at the end of the day, we can pass it on. We have been increasing prices even during the pandemic. And we've seen also uptick in demand still.
Okay. What sort of increases in prices have you had to implement in the last 12 to 24 months?
Yeah, in line with the inflation.
Okay, just in line with the inflation. All right. On that note, Brian, thank you so much for taking our call this morning. Good luck in this VREIT. We're looking forward to more exciting news from your end. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you, guys.